morning, Westside. Happy Mother's Day to all the mothers out there that have been good influences in all of our lives. We're here to celebrate you and also worship our Father together. So I'm going to open us up in prayer, and then we'll get started. Dear God, thank you so much for this morning. Thank you for the day we get to be here and celebrate mothers and also worship you, for giving us life, and you gave us life as well. Help us to worship well, with an open heart, and just have a good time and enjoy each other's presence. Just Spirit, lead us today. In your name, amen. If you want to stand up with us.
Son of God, the perfect, spotless one. Thank you. stone, manna on the ground, no matter where I go. I don't need to worry now that I know everything I need you got. There's honey in the rock, perfect sacred plan, power in the blood, healing in your hands. Started flowing when you said it is done. Jesus, do you are enough? Honey in the rock.
We can come and lift you up and worship you and say your name, the name of Jesus. And we don't have to worry about being arrested or in fear of being put in jail. You've given us that freedom in this state, in this country, that we can worship you. There's places around the world that don't have that freedom, that they have to hide and secrecy to praise you and worship you, to pray to you. But Lord, we don't have to do that here. That we're free to do that. I just praise you for that. Lord, most of all today, being Mother's Day, we're thankful for each and every mother. Because Lord, we all have one. Whether they're still here or they've gone on before us, Lord, we all have one. And I just think about all they teach us from the time we're little to even when we're full grown. They teach us love and mercy and kindness and wisdom, even toughness when it's needed, Lord. But they're not perfect, but they just do the best they can do each and every day. Lord, I'm thankful for them, thankful for each and every single mother. We lift them up today, Lord, but most of all, we're thankful for you, thankful for the freedom that you do give us, thankful for the love you give us, the grace and mercy, the kindness, love, the toughness, all of those things, Lord, that you came on this earth to teach us how to live, how to love, but most of all, give your life for us. Lord, that'd be my prayer today, that if somebody does not know you, that they would come to know you, Lord, just to give you a chance. Maybe they're tired of just running this race on their own. Maybe they're tired of the difficulties of life, Lord. They're tired of doing it on their own. Lord, I tried that. It doesn't work. You put in us a desire and a need for you. And without that connection, Lord, that's just difficult. But Lord, that'd be my prayer today, that somebody does not know you, they would come to know you, Lord. That they'd give their life to you. Turn from their ways, Lord, and lift you up. You're a great Savior, a great Lord, a great God. You're very forgiving. But you're also... keep us held responsible, Lord. But Lord, we lift you up today. Thank you for a great place we can come and worship you, lift you up through song, through prayer, through a message, Lord. Pray for Pastor John as he shares a message in just a moment, Lord. We lift him up to you, Lord. Hide him behind the cross. And may his words be your words and your words only. For Lord Jesus, let me pray. Amen.
Thank you, worship team. Thank you, Darren. Good morning. Welcome to Westside. We're glad you're here this morning. Happy Mother's Day again. Just want to ask you a couple things. If you're in the center pew there, if you'll grab that stack of connection cards, take one and pass it down just to the aisle there. That's just a way for us to just keep track of who's here. If you're a first-time guest, if you'll just fill out that contact information there. If you're a regular attender, you're a member, all you need to do is just drop your name on that and then save that and then put it in the offering plate at the end of the service and just have that record of your attendance. Also, the bulletin, hopefully you got one of those when you got in this morning. The tear-off section, we say it every week, is a place for you to drop prayer requests, anything that we can pray for you about, we'd be glad to do that. And if you'd mark it confidential, that just goes to me, or you can mark it for the weekly Wednesday prayer sheet. We'll put it in there as well. So but we're glad you're here. I'm going to show a brief video here. So if you'll just direct your attention to the screens. And we'll come back in just a minute.
Just give me 1 second.
Sure.
Thank you. Sorry. Hey. Hi. 2 minutes. Thank you. Hi. Good afternoon. Sorry about
that. Hey, Oi.
Hi, nice to meet you.
Nice to meet you as well. Have you ever done one of these interviews over the camera before?
No.
Well, let me tell you a little bit about the job to get started with. It's not just a job, it's sort of probably the most important job. The title that we have going right now is Director of Operations, but it's really kind of so much more than that. Responsibilities and requirements are really quite extensive. First category for the requirements would be mobility. This job requires that you must be able to work standing up most or really all of the time, constantly on your feet, constantly bending over, constantly exerting yourself, a high level of stamina.
Okay.
That's a lot.
For how many hours?
135 hours to unlimited hours a week. It's basically 24 hours a day, 7 days a week.
I'm sure you'll have a chance from time to time to maybe just sit down here and there, yeah?
You mean like a break?
Yeah.
No, there are no breaks available.
Is that even legal?
Oh, yeah, of course, yeah.
Okay,
yeah.
So like no lunch?
You can have lunch, but only when the associate is done eating their lunch.
I think that's a little intense.
No,
not possible.
That's crazy.
Now, this position requires excellent negotiation and interpersonal skill. We're really looking for someone that might have a degree in medicine, in finance, and the culinary arts. You must be able to wear several hats. Associate needs constant attention. Sometimes they have to stay up with an associate throughout the night. Being able to work in a chaotic environment, if you had a life, we'd ask you to sort of give that life up. No vacations. In fact, Thanksgiving, Christmas, New Year's, and holidays, the workload is going to go up, and we demand that with a happy disposition.
That's almost cruel. That's almost a very, very sick, twisted joke.
Worry about when there's time to sleep or...
Oh, no time to sleep.
Yeah, all encompassing almost.
That's exactly right.
365 days a year?
Yes.
No, that's inhumane.
That's very insane.
The meaningful connections that you make and the feeling that you get from really helping your associate are immeasurable. Also, let's cover the salary. The position is going to pay absolutely nothing.
Excuse me?
No. Nobody's doing that for free.
Yeah, pro bono. Completely for free.
No!
What if I told you there's someone that actually currently holds this position right now? Billions of people, actually.
Who?
Moms.
Yeah.
Yeah. Moms.
That's awesome.
Oh!
And they meet every requirement, don't
wow.
they?
Oh my God. Moms are the best.
Yeah, there's no pay. They're 24 hours. They're always there.
Now I'm thinking about my mom.
Yeah, and what are you thinking about her?
I'm thinking about all those nights and everything.
Thank you so much for everything you do. I know it doesn't seem like I appreciate all of it, but I definitely do.
So, Mom, I want to say thank you for everything that you've done. I love you very much. You've been there through thick and thin. My mom is just awesome. She's awesome.
Amen. All right. Then that an accurate job description right there. I love the, you must have a degree in medicine, culinary arts, and all that stuff. Everything. So, all right. Well, we just want to take a minute and recognize the moms this morning. If you are a mom, whether it's a few months or 60 years a mom, would you just stand up? And I want to ask for some help. Yeah. Amen. Y'all give them a round of applause. Yeah, thank you, Dave and Bobby. We got a gift. If you'll remain standing until we give you a gift here. Now, I'll tell you a little bit of a secret. We've got these tumblers for you this morning, and it wasn't the one we wanted to give you. It was something else, but it was a little cheaper, so I did the right thing, and I stuffed it with chocolate to make up the difference. So, there we go. So please take one of those. After all the moms have gotten a tumbler, you can sit down. If there's some left over and you're going to go see your mom maybe today or sometime this week, if you want to take one to her, you can do that. But let's make sure that everybody here gets one of those, and you can just come down here at the end of the service and get one of those and take it to your mom as well. So thank you so much, moms, for taking care of us, because we all know the truth. Sometimes us dads, we just don't, we can't think of 12 things at one time. So moms have that ability to do that. So I believe most of us. All right. Well, let's just take a few minutes and let's greet one another in the Lord. Let's stand up, hug each other, handshake, whatever you feel is appropriate. And we'll come back in just a few minutes with our message.
I met you.
job, good job. All right. Thank you, Zachary. Zachary and they filled in. Mercy and Devin are out of town this week. Devin graduated from seminary this week, so we're going to celebrate him. Yep. Yeah. I tell you, he's aching for punishment. He's already decided he's going to go back and work on his doctorate. I'm like, oh man, better you than me. So no, thank you. But he loves that. And anyway, so we'll next week. Just as a reminder, too, next week is when we're going to honor our high school graduates. And if we have any college graduates here, we'd like to honor you too. Just stand up if you'll send us an email, send me a text or whatever this week. Just let me know. Hey, I'm graduating. This is my degree. Or maybe you have a son or grandson. We will mention them as well too. But that'll be next Sunday. Before I get into the sermon, next Sunday after church, the students are going to have a lunch after church next Sunday to help provide support funds for the scholarship students to be able to go to camp. We've done really well collecting a lot of that. Just lacked just a little bit left. We thought we'll have a dinner. So they're going to have hot dogs, chips, drinks, some desserts, stuff like that. And the cost per plate is $10. And if it goes, you get a good meal and you can take that money and put it, and that will go towards the students going to camp. If I can get just I didn't have a sign-up sheet this week out there in the foyer for that, but if you're planning on being here for that meal, would you just slip your hand up real quick? I just want to kind of get a ballpark figure to see what we're looking at. Okay, thank you. That's good. Appreciate that. That way we'll make sure we get all that taken care of. But that'll be next week after the service there. And the cost is $10 a plate. So you can give more if you want to, but it's $10. All right. We're trucking along through the Relationship 101 series we've been going through for the last month and a half or so, and looking at different aspects of relationships. We've talked about what healthy relationships are. We've looked at communication, forgiveness. We've looked at a little bit of how to handle conflict biblically in relationships, a lot of different areas. Last week it was about friendships. Today, being Mother's Day, I thought let's look at the family relationships. Let's see where, you know, what God wants us to see from Scripture about our families and how we're supposed to live together. Sometimes that's easier said than done. Amen. So, you know, the family is God's basic building block. You know, before there was the organization of the church, family was first. And that's how God intended for us to grow up together in a family. You know, mom and dad, kids, all that. So it's how God intends us to function. But, you know this. It's not a surprise. But the world takes family and they try to morph it into something completely different. They'll say it's this or that. You know, we're in a day and age now where they distort it and redefine family and say, well, you can have two dads or you can have two moms and all sorts of, I'm sure there's other combinations now that I don't even know about, you know. But there's that idea there. And I think, too, we're in a time of very, 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 like a rugged individualism in our family. And sometimes it's all about the single individual, and sometimes the family gets pushed back and maybe not as important as it should be. You know, there's a lot of single parents, and I even hesitate to you know, talk about the statistics. In Gwinnett County, I was looking at the overall single parent homes in the United States, and it's about 39% of the homes in the United States make up single parent homes. Here in Gwinnett, we're a little better, if you will. It's about 29.2% according to the 2019 survey that I looked at. But but that's a struggle, and, you know. And I think here's the thing: the lie says, "Well, it's okay. You know, you can be a single parent home and be just as fine." I'm not, and I'm please hear me. I'm not saying if you're here and you're in a single parent home household, I'm not saying you did anything wrong or what anything like that. But there's this lie from the world that says it's just as good or the same as a family with a mom and dad in it. And that's what the world seems to kind of push off there. There again, I think is where we can miss it. You know, some people have the idea of the family is it's all about materialism. You know, what can I build up for my family? What can I gather together and build my castle, quote unquote, for my family? I was at a home yesterday. Oh my goodness. There was a graduation party for one of the students, and it was at a home that was hosted this party. My goodness, I thought, wow. I was like, I hope my mansion in heaven's going to be like this, you know, one day. But there are people that make the success of the family the only thing that matters. Man, you've got to get the good job, you've got to get this and collect all this stuff, and that's what family is about, you know, and that's not really it either. Thinking about a lot of different things with the media, man, things have changed in my day on TV programs, movies. I remember the first quote-unquote dysfunctional family that was on TV was the Roseanne Barr show. What was the name of that? Roseanne. Are you right there? Okay. You know, it kind of portrayed this, you know, and now it seems like all the TV shows kind of display, well, this is normal, and this is the way that it's going to be, and there's no hope for anything better or anything like that, you know, and fussing and fighting and all that. Let's put it together there. And I think when you say, what are you saying, Pastor? Well, I think when we're overwhelmed with media like that constantly, it kind of deludes this idea that maybe there's something better that God has for us, but we're so used to seeing it one way portrayed on social media or TV and all this stuff, we just kind of give up, and we don't strive for an ideal that God has for us with family. So a lot of different ways. So we're going to go this morning, if you have your Bible, we're going to be in Titus chapter 2 for the most part of the sermon this morning. And we're going to look at what I believe are some godly ideals for us as family to have here. Titus chapter 2, I'm going to read the first 8 verses here. We're going to look at 3 different aspects of what a godly family entails here. If you can, if you're able to, if you'll just stand in honor of God's word while I read it, starting in verse 1 here. Paul says, "You must teach what is in accordance with sound doctrine. Teach the older men to be temperate, worthy of respect, self-controlled, and sound in faith, in love, and endurance. Likewise, teach the older women to be reverent in the way that they live, not to be slanderers or addicted to much wine, but to teach what is good. Then they can train the younger women to love their husbands and children, and to be self-controlled and pure, to be busy at home, to be kind, to be subject to their husbands, so that no one will malign the word of God. Similarly, encourage the young men to be self-controlled and everything, set them an example by doing what is good. In your teaching, show integrity, seriousness, soundness of speech that cannot be condemned, so that those who oppose you may be ashamed because they have nothing bad to say about us." I'll stop right there. Thank you. You can have a seat. Paul is addressing these different groups here in the letter to Titus, and he brings up these different people. We're going to kind of break that down at the last point here, but 3 things I want to share with you this morning. I want to point out to you on the outline there. It's on the back of your bulletin if you want to follow along, but number 1, godly families teach what is right and set an example to the world. Godly families teach what is right and set an example to the world. That's the very first verse in this passage right there. Look at verse 1. He says, you must teach what is in accord with sound doctrine. That's the place that we start right there. Before Paul begins talking about all the individual instructions for the different age groups, the older men, the younger men, the older women, younger women, he starts out with saying, we have to teach what's sound doctrine right there. So my question this morning is, how do we know, church, what is sound doctrine and what's not? If you know anything about the Secret Service, not only do they guard the president, but the Secret Service is also in charge of looking over counterfeit money. That's one of their responsibilities. And the way that the Secret Service determines how they can know what is fake is by studying the original, right? When you know what the original is, what the paper, it's actually not paper, it's like a linen mixture, right? But when they know what the linen paper feels like and all the little intricacies in there and all the holograms and all the little details in that, when you know that really well, it makes it easier to spot the fake. And so for us, how do we know to teach sound doctrine? And what is sound and what is not? Well, I mean, obviously that goes to knowing what God's Word says here. That's what we have to be in. If we're going to be godly moms and dads, children, and we're going to teach what is right, it starts by building that in the Word of God, right? You know, what is your view of the Word of God today? Does it have authority in your life? Do you trust it? Or do you look at the Bible like, well, I don't know about that. The world says this, and the Bible is opposite of that, and so you may doubt the Word of God. That's a place for us to start and to look at right there. So many Christians today do not have a biblical worldview. George Barna, who's a part of Arizona Christian University, they put out surveys all the time, and they're probably one of the biggest organizations that does surveys. They have something they do about every 2 years. They call it the Worldview Inventory Report, and they ask these same questions year after year after year, and they use it to get a judgment on where people are at. And this came out in 2022, and this is pretty scary to me as a pastor, but it's this, that in 2022, in their latest World Inventory Report, they discovered that only 9% of people who claim and profess to be a Christian have a biblical worldview. That's one out of every 10. Only 9% of people, and again, people can claim to be a Christian, and maybe they are, and maybe they think they are, right? You know, but of all those, and it's like a 10,000 person survey, it's a pretty big section of that, but 9% of people who claim to be Christian have a biblical worldview. Well, wow. Well, what's the cause of that? Well, that's the next stat I'm going to give you. They've also, same study, they surveyed pastors and church leaders. This is where it gets really depressing to me. they've discovered, church, that only about 39% of pastors have a biblical worldview. 39%. Now, that breakdown of 39% covers all, like, children's pastors, youth pastors, lead pastors, executive pastors, all that stuff. If you look at just the senior adult pastors, it's like 41%, and it goes down from there. The executive pastor was like, it was like in the 20s. I was like, whoa, that's less than 50%. So no wonder if the church doesn't have a biblical worldview, it probably has something to do with the pastor who's preaching in the church they're at. And so, church, I can't emphasize enough, Where are you at with God's word? Do you trust it? Does it have authority in your life and in my life? Do we go to it so that, you know, again, if God is our creator and he created the whole universe and us, and it, he knows us best, we ought to pay attention and see what he has to say to us about that. I discovered the most, I guess, the majority view of in these surveys is something called syncretism. And it's basically this idea that it's like you take anything from this and this and this, and you just create about 60% of the people they interviewed, they've come up with their own beliefs just on their own. It's like a buffet. I love buffets, right? You know, you go, you can get a little bit of this, a little bit of this, and that, and you can come back and you get seconds and thirds. I remember one time on a mission trip, we went and one of the students got a whole plate of mac and cheese. That's all he got. But, you know, a buffet is great. I mean, you can choose what you want, but a spiritual buffet is not good. I mean, there's great variety in things, but we can't decide, well, I like this over here. I'm going to choose what's right and wrong based on my friend group over here, and then I'm going to think, well, you know, reincarnation is a good idea. I'm going to believe that's true, and maybe I can find that in the Bible too. And many people just piece their beliefs together in this syncretistic way, and that's where most people are today. And you know, we live in a very relative world, society. A lot of different beliefs, a lot of different people from everywhere, and it's like people are treating their spiritual beliefs like this buffet, and that's something we should not do. We got to be careful with this. Paul mentions several places here, and this is the second part to the message here. You know, we must teach what is right, but there's a reason for it. It says to set an example for the world. Several places here. Look at verse 5 and verse 8. Paul says there, so that no one will malign the word of God. And in verse 8, he says, so that no one has anything bad to say about us. There's a reason, not only for our own benefit to teach sound doctrine, but think about all the people who misrepresent the Christian faith by not living how the Word of God says. You know, I've been following several accounts on social media. They would put the hashtag deconstruction on their ex-evangelical and just trying to see what they say and what they're talking about. And many of these people who are losing and leaving the Christian faith, they'll tell you why. Well, I did this and this happened. Many of their reasons, not all, but many of the reasons are not Christian biblical principles. They're when people mess up and when people misrepresent the truth. And so there's a danger if you and I don't live a sound biblical life that we're misrepresenting the Word of God and our Savior to people. And they're looking at them like, well, I don't want anything to do with that because the way you act or the things that you believe. And all, you know. And so we really need to pay attention to that. It's not only for our own benefit and for our families, but there are people that look at us and watch us. And we have to be very, very, very careful with that. Every family is teaching something, right? Every family, every parent is teaching their children something. The question is, what are we teaching our children? Are we teaching them biblical things? Or are we just kind of going along with the rest of the world and what they say and what they're doing there? So, and then secondly, what are we showing to the world around us? If we have certain things that we're doing that are not biblical, who is paying attention to us? Who knows that we are Christians and that we claim to live for Christ and go to church? And how is that maybe misrepresenting Christ or skewing or blurring it perhaps? That's one thing that I think we need to look at. So that's important. All right, number two on your outline there. Number two is godly families need each other. Godly families need each other. Or I changed my mind after I typed it. It was too late. It's already in the bulletin. But maybe we should say something like, godly families rely on each other. We need each other, okay? Children, you need your parents. Students, you need your parents. And parents, guess what? You need your children. You need the students in your life. This is something that's important. And you know, I thought about this too in relation to the church. It's the same way. I don't know if you would be here this morning and you consider yourself a young person or an old person. So if you consider yourself a young person, I want you to repeat after me. All right, just say it out loud right here. I need old people.
I need old people.
Okay, all right. If you consider yourself an older person, or like I said this morning, most experienced person, I want you to repeat after me. I need young people. Okay, all right. That is true. All right, some of you guys sound like you weren't sure about that. You're like, I don't know. But church, we need each other. We do. It's just like the family. Children need their parents. Parents need children. It's a symbiotic relationship there that God has put in there. This is one thing I think many Hispanic families do well. They look after each other. They care for each other. A lot of times in many homes there in the Hispanic community, there are like multiple families that live together right there, and there's aunts and uncles and all that. You know, they're helping each other out. That is not the case for a lot of our traditional American families. We've kind of developed this idea like, all right, I'm going to grow up my family and just tolerate them. Then I'm going to get out and do my own thing and have my own family. That's not how God intended it to be. We need each other. I've been reading this book called A New Kind of Diversity by Tim Elmore. Great book, and it's all about working with multi-generations. We've got kind of that on our staff here. We've got several generations. I'm like, well, maybe this will help me out here. It's giving me a lot of good ideas. There's a quote in here, and I'm like, oh, this is good. All right, if you think, and this is by a guy named Derek Johnson. He says, if you think you are smarter than the previous generation, consider this. 50 years ago, in car manuals, it taught you how to adjust the valves. Today, the car manuals tell you not to drink the battery acid. Okay. And I thought about, do we put some stuff on there? I saw one on the social media this week. It was a pizza box, and it said, open before eating pizza. And I was like, are we really that? You know, anyway. But if you think you're smarter than the previous generation, Just think about that for just a minute. Yeah, you know, I can't imagine. Some of you probably know how to adjust the valves in your car. I have no idea. I have no idea. But students, young people, listen to me. It would be very wise for you to listen to your parents. This is key. They have experience. You may not agree with everything, right? I understand. Guess what? Your parents don't agree with everything either on you too. But they've got the experience and the knowledge, and they've gone through life, and you would be a fool if you did not take your parents' advice, if you did not listen to them. And old people, you and I, because I guess I consider myself old. I was like, where's the dividing line? Is it like 35? Is that, you know, I'm old. But older people, we would be wise to listen and include young people in our lives too. We don't want to make the same mistake that the Kodak company did. Now, years ago, Kodak was the camera company. They were the top notch. They had everything going. They were producing film and all the cameras. And many of you, anybody have a Kodak camera when you were younger? A few of you? Okay, a couple of you, all right. Well, Kodak made the mistake of not doing something they could have done. After the camera was developed, then came this idea of digital photography. Kodak, in fact, was one of the leading developers in digital photography. They figured out how to do this, but they had this idea and they said, no, we can't change, we can't morph our company to go towards digital cameras because we produce so much of this film, and if people go to digital cameras, we won't sell near enough of our Kodak film anymore. So they did nothing. And what happened is other companies came along, developed digital camera, and now Kodak's still around today, but they're nothing compared to the company that they used to be on the top of everything there. And so I share that, old people, including myself, that we can't be like Kodak. We can't say, you know what, I've always done it this way before, and I'm always going to do the same thing, because the world is constantly changing around us. We need to talk to young people, and we need to hear them, and we need to engage with them, and they're very creative and smart, and they can help us together. And so again, old people, you need young people. Young people, you need old people. I don't know why I pointed to different sides, whatever. But I mean, we all need each other, and that's the same way in the family, and that's what God intended it to be. God intended us to be together and not to be separate and be a part of all this. We have to learn to adapt and work together as families and as a church even as well. This is even in our vision statement with the church. If you want to go ahead and put it up, Ava, there on the screen. Sorry, I jumped on there. But here it is. The scripture there, it says, "Train the younger women, encourage the younger men." You see, this is what God intended for it to do there, for parents and for the church to train young people there. All right, go to the next slide there, Ava. All right, in our mission statement here at Westside, we have these three kind of, I don't know what you call them, kind of base foundations. Is it up there? Maybe not. I go to the next one. I thought I put it in there. Maybe not. All right, but if you look on the bulletin right there, you see there's three, under our logo, you have three real two-word phrases, right? And it just says basically this. It says, all neighbors, all nations, and then the last one is all generations, right? That's what our church is for. We want to see all our neighbors, no matter if they're on this side of 78 or this side. We want to see all of them welcome at Westside. We want to see all nations, people from all over the world that are welcome here at Westside, and we want to make sure that all generations know that they're welcome to come to Westside and to worship here. That's important. I don't know what happened to my logo, but that's okay. We'll just move on. We'll go right on here. Let me just say this, and I'll move on. And I hope you guys realize, every single generation, church, has something to give. You might look at yourself, I'm too old, I can't do blah, 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 whatever. I'm too young, I can't do blah, blah, blah. Every generation has something to give. That's true in the church, and that's true in your family. Everybody's a part of the family, okay? All right, number three on your outline there. Godly families must fulfill their roles in the family. Godly families must fulfill their roles in the family. And this is where I want to just quickly kind of go through some of these points that Paul talked about in Titus here. First, if you will, if you want to flip over to Ephesians chapter 6, we'll read this passage right here. And I was reading this, and I had a little aha moment here, and I'm like, this is perfect for Mother's Day. Ephesians chapter 6 is kind of what we consider, sometimes it's referred to as the household codes, how a family should work together here. Many of you are familiar with this, but starting in verse 1, it says, "Children, obey your parents in the Lord, for this is right. Honor your father and mother, which is the first commandment with a promise, that it may go well with you, and that you may enjoy a long life on the earth." Verse 4, "Fathers, do not exasperate your children, children. Instead, bring them up in the training and the instruction of the Lord. Anybody notice anybody missing in those verses right there? Mothers. Mothers. Okay. I know Paul was married, so he probably understood. Well, you know, he gives instructions to the kids, he gives instructions to the dads, but he doesn't say anything to the moms, right? Because, and I heard it's because they're doing everything right. I heard somebody whisper that. Maybe. He probably knew. He probably knew men need a little bit more of a kick in the pants, maybe, than moms do sometimes. But these are these basic instructions here. I want to go real quickly with you. Just, you know, again, children, it says, children, obey your parents in the Lord. All right? It doesn't say in just this area or just that area. That involves every area. Obey your parents in the Lord. Now, the very next verse in verse 2, it says, honor your father and your mother. And it goes back and talks about referencing the commandment there in Exodus. But do you know the difference between obedience and honoring? They're different. Obedience requires, you know, adhering to maybe what someone has told you to do. That's obedience. You know, go clean your room. Okay, got to, you know, do this. But honoring your father and your mother, that's different. That's a little more wide. You know, maybe we got a young man in the audience who's going to be getting married next week. And I'm excited for you. But there, you know, when you become married, perhaps, when you have your family, maybe you, well, I don't have to obey my mom and dad anymore. Okay, maybe not. You're your own family now, right? But I believe you and I all have a responsibility to continue to honor our father and mother.
Amen.
That goes much further than just, you know, just those children's year, 0 to 18 or something like that. We can still continue to honor our fathers and mothers, even though we ourselves might be 20, 30, 40, 50 years old. And we can honor them. So, but just for good measure, Paul includes them both here. He said, children, you're supposed to obey your mom and dad, but guess what? You're also supposed to honor them too. And I would almost say it's easy to obey things and do stuff. The harder thing might be to honor. To honor them with our attitudes and by honoring them that way. So that's that. And then the instructions for the father, he says, fathers, do not exasperate your children there. That means to kind of provoke to anger and like in excess. Now, kids, that doesn't mean, ha, dad, the Bible says that you can't make me angry. No, that's not what it's saying. That's not going to happen. But in excess, okay? We can't be too hard, parents, moms, or dads. We cannot be too hard on our children and push them to the point where we push them away. And I understand sometimes that's a hard, tough love situation and all that, but you know, if we know we're being overly harsh, that does affect our the way we parent and discipline our children too. So that's our responsibility as parents, even though Paul just said fathers. So, but if you want to flip back now to Titus, I just want to briefly go over here in the last 5 minutes here some of these basic instructions here for the older men, older women, and younger men that Paul goes through here. We read them, and I just want to encourage you. You know, take some time, go back and read through Titus chapter 2 just a little bit here, and really say, you know, you may identify, well, I'm an older man, I'm a younger woman, whatever. Go back and look at what Paul is saying here. But to the older men first, he says, be temperate, self-controlled. He says, worthy of respect. That's one thing right there. Worthy of respect. In other words, we don't get respect just because. We have to earn it. We have to be older men. We've got to earn that respect. Sound in love, faith, and endurance. tendency, I think, for many older men and some older women, sometimes we, the older we get, we lose that self-control to kind of hold our tongues and our attitudes. You know what? I've done this for 20 years. I'm just going to let it go right now. So that's something we need to watch out for, whether we're talking to our spouses or our children or grandchildren, whoever it might be. To the older women, Paul says there, be reverent, not slanderers or addicted to much wine. Teach what is good. And again, I think as we age, we naturally kind of, we lose that ability to be kind and compassionate. And we become a little more rough around the edges. And Paul is saying here, hey, no, you still got to hold that reverence. You can't just run people over with a steamroller because you're older than somebody else in the family. You've got to still talk and act in self-control and reverence there. So to the younger women is the next group of categories there. He says the older women are to teach the younger women to love their husbands and their children. You're like, what? Don't they already know how to do that? Well, no, there's there's a lot more involved in that. To really love husbands, because husbands are husbands. But love their husbands and children. It says to be subject to their husbands. Whoa, wait a minute, Pastor John. It's 2024. Wait a minute. Women have to be subject to that? Well, again, church, I'm here to teach you the truth, sound doctrine. The Bible teaches that the man is the head of the family. This goes all the way back to Genesis. Okay? But if you're still frustrated, this doesn't mean that you have to do exactly what the man says and everything. That's different. That's but to be subject to his leadership for your family. Okay? But if you're struggling with that, ladies, I want to encourage you. Paul also says in Ephesians that husbands, you have to love your wives as Christ loved the church. And what is that? That means you have to be willing to die for your wives. So it goes both ways. It's both ways. It's both and there. But to be subject to their husbands, the younger women are to be busy at home, to be kind and pure. And then finally, to the younger men, Paul says there, be self-controlled, integrity, to be serious. Ooh, that hit me right between the eyes. Soundness of speech. As I was looking at that, yeah, there's many issues right there that I think young men could take a lot from and grab. And so there's something for all of us. We all have a role in the family. Some of us, God has instilled as the spiritual leader of the families. Others of us are the spouse. Others are children. And we're all supposed to work together for the good of the family. I have seen, wow. I have seen so much race recently. And again, our world is not friendly to the biblical idea of family right now. It's hard to live right now with the economy and everything going on. I mean, things are crazy. And we need a godly idea of a family, I believe, to help us make it through the crazy times in which we're living in. It's hard. If you're a single parent and you're doing it, my hat is off to you, because I know as a dual parent family, and it's hard for me. And some of you are, you all are knocking it out of the park. You're awesome single parents. But it's harder. I know, because you don't have another parent in the home with you, helping you, and tag teaming and doing everything that needs to be done. And that is just why it's so important for us to go back to the biblical idea, the model that God has set for us all in God's idea of the family. So last thing that we're going to land this plane is this. I want to tell you, and you probably already know this, but if you don't, you know, church, that God wants you to be a part of his family. God wants you to be a part of his family. There's a scripture in the Gospel of John, chapter 1. If you want to go ahead and put it on the screen, Ava, there. But this is John chapter 1, verses 12 and 13. It says this, says, yet to all all who received him, to those who believed in his name, he gave the right to become children of God. And children not born of natural descent or human decision or husband's will, but born of God. Are you a part of that family today? Are you a part of God's family? You may say, well, I don't know, Pastor John. How do I know if I'm in God's family? The Bible says that you make the decision to join God's family, to trust him by faith, to come and say, I want to be a part of God's family. And here's the good news. God welcomes everybody into his family. He denies no one. Anyone who comes to him, he welcomes into the family there. And let me just give you the gospel in a nutshell. We do this every single week. But it just to remind you, you know, you're not an accident, church. If you're here today, you're wondering what's life about, what's going on, what's my purpose, all this stuff. I just want to tell you this morning, you're not an accident. God created you with a purpose, for a purpose. And, you know, Colossians 1:16 says this. It says, for by him and through him were all things created. Go ahead and go to the next slide there, Ava. Thank you. So you're not an accident. Secondly, but you and I are apart from God because of something, and that's because of our sin. Romans 3:23 says, for all have sinned and fallen short of the glory of God. The Romans 6:23 says there's a punishment for our sin. It says, for the wages of sin is death. If you're not familiar with what wages are, think about like a paycheck. Your wage is what you receive at the end of your pay period. So what we earn because of our sin is death. Well, that's all bad news, but guess what? God knew that we would not be able to take care of that debt ourselves, and so that's why he sent Jesus Christ to come to the earth, to die on the cross for our sins, and he rose victoriously 3 days later from the tomb. You know, it says God approached us through Jesus Christ. God approached us through Jesus Christ. Jesus is God. He became man, was born of a little baby. He grew up, he taught, did a lot of miracles, but Jesus' main purpose to come to the earth was to die for our sins. And if you believe that, then if you understand that and believe it, then you can be a part of God's family too. And the last one is this, that we accept Jesus Christ by faith. The Bible, you may be here this morning like, well, how do I do this? Well, we accept Jesus Christ by faith. It's not by being a good person, trying to do good deeds. We can trust Christ and begin a relationship with him by putting our faith or trust in him. Ephesians 2:8 says, for by grace are you saved through faith, not of yourselves. It's the gift of God. God wants to give you a gift of eternal life and being a part of his family. If you understand that gospel kind of in a nutshell, if you're ready this morning to be a part of God's family, I just want to help you do that. I'm going to ask everybody to bow your heads, close your eyes. Nobody getting up, moving around yet. If you'd like to begin a relationship and be a part of God's family this morning, you can do that through a simple prayer. Say something like this to God. You can either whisper it quietly or say it in your head. Say this to the Lord. Say, dear God, I know that you love me. I know that I'm a sinner. But I believe that Jesus came to die for my sins. Today, God, I'm coming to you, and I want to be a part of your family. Receive me into your family. Forgive me my sins as I place my faith and trust in you. Give me eternal life. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. In just a minute, our worship team is going to come back and we're going to sing an invitation song. It's a time for us to respond, maybe to just spend some time in prayer. Maybe the Lord has spoken to us. And I just want to ask you, if you prayed that prayer this morning and asked God to come into your life and to be part of his family, would you just come down? Would you have the courage just to come down? You don't have to give a speech or anything. Would you just come shake my hand and say, Pastor John, I prayed that prayer. today. All I want to do is just help you and give you a few pointers, the things that you can do to grow in your new relationship, being a part of God's family. Christians, some of you have already made that decision. You've trusted Christ many years ago or recently. Is there something in the family that we need to work on? Are we fulfilling the roles that God has for us? Is it time for us parents, moms, dads, to take a more active role in our children's spiritual discipleship and walk? I mean, the church is great, and we're here for you as the kids ministry and the student ministry, but parents, you're the number one disciples of your own children. Is it time for us to own that? You know, I saw a stat the other day talking about sports and things. It's something like 0.002% of high school students will ever make it to the professional level in sports, football, basketball, whatever. So that's like 0.1%. It's very small. But then the thing says 100% of us will stand before God. What's more important? Are we trying to push our kids in all the sports and all the things to be successful, but we've been neglecting their spiritual relationship with the Lord? Is it time to start focusing on those things? It's not too late. God can do stuff in an instant through the power of His Holy Spirit. You know, for others of us, is there an attitude? Are we here this morning and we're struggling with our parents? Or parents, are we struggling with our children? Is there something in the family that we need to get right? I just want to encourage you this morning. Whatever the Lord is putting on your heart, let's handle that. Let's have those conversations this week about how important the family is. So let's pray, and then we'll have our last song. God, this is your time. Lord, I pray that your Holy Spirit will just have the freedom to move this morning and to speak to us. Lord, if we need to stand out and come down and make a decision to walk forward this morning, I pray that we'll do that. Lord, if we need to go home and think about what it means to be a godly parent, a godly son or a daughter, I pray that we'll do that too, that we'll be of sound doctrine. We'll do what your word teaches us to do. Lord, it's for our benefit and our good, but ultimately, God, it's because it's what you desire for us. We pray all these things. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. If you'll stand.
I count it all.
song, Lord. We want to be led to the cross, Lord. That's where you paid the debt for us, Lord. That's where you made everything right that was wrong, Lord. God, you created it. We as people, we broke it. But Jesus, you fixed it, Lord. Help us to remember that and to always give you praise and honor for all you've done, Lord. Lord, I pray as we kind of close out this invitation, I pray that that many of us will continue to think about the message we've heard, your word, and Lord, may it challenge us and change us. Lord, now as we come, we give our tithes and offerings to you, Lord. I pray that you will take the gifts that are given this morning. You'll bless it, multiply it. You'll use it for your ministry here at Westside. Lord, we love you, and we just pray all these things in the powerful name of Jesus, I pray. Amen.